Iran is the victim of another false flag operation. And we don't know exactly who's done it, but it's obviously connected to the U.S. deep state who does these things. The biggest thing that has turned Donald Trump, and he's, by the way, has been very reluctant to buy into this Iran war scenario up until today, when he finally got convinced, because they pulled they have a two or three levels of false flag or false intelligence information they can deliver to the president. They used all three today. And the first one, of course, was the several weeks ago, the mines that hit four tankers in the UAE. And today, of course, yesterday, there were these tankers that were hit. But, you know, they show this boat, as you're showing on screen right now, coming up and supposedly removing a limpet mine from the side of the ship.
Is the U.S. involved with any procuring of weapons, transfer of weapons, buying, selling, anyhow transferring weapons to Turkey out of Libya?
To Turkey?
It is a big idea, a new world order.
How is it that this organization is so well-funded, so organized?
Islamic State-linked militants have gained a stronger foothold in Libya, seizing new economically vital areas of the country.
The leader of ISIS in Libya is none other than Abdel Hakim Belhaj. And of course, he was armed to the teeth by NATO.
A world in which there is the very real prospect of a new world order.
The Russians say they're negotiating with North Korea to hold joint military exercises. Kim Jong-un and Vladimir Putin teaming up, creating an ominous alliance against the United States.
Israel's Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu is aggressively opposing the nuclear deal that the U.S. government is negotiating with Iran.
Saudi Arabia is apparently prepared to allow Israeli jets into its airspace to conduct attacks on Iran.
We have an unprecedented opportunity to build a new world order.
I set up a foundation in Ukraine and played an important part in events now.
Ukraine is set to receive the first tranche of an International Monetary Fund aid package.
We had brokered a deal to transition power in Ukraine.
Vladimir Putin is on the move.
Only when this transformation is complete will we be able to take full measure of the opportunities presented by this new and evolving world order.
It's known as the Bilderberg Group. Could their objective be world domination?
All right, I'm going to have my lawyer from Connecticut, he's pretty famous, Norm Pattis, in studio with how they're trying to set us up. He flew down here last night because of this. But let me tell you, the game has moved into the next level right now. We're going to have exclusive information. We've been in contact with the FBI. We have all the proof that we're the victims of this. But this is what the Democrats are doing now to shut down their competition, to shut down people that are fighting them. And what we're going through, you can imagine all the other people supporting Trump are being persecuted, are being lied about, are being absolutely harassed. And I'm not a victim. I'm glad this is happening, quite frankly. I love it. I'm not a sadomasochist. I'm not into pain, but if it means pain to get something done, I'll do it all day long. So he'll be in studio in the fourth hour with us, and the media's been alerted. This will be a big national news story when we cover it. And of course, he's running the whole murder trial up in Connecticut. He came down here to cover this. You can imagine it's pretty big. That murder trial is the biggest news in the country. It probably shouldn't be. The whole situation with the ship and Iran and who's behind it. Neocons said we could have Navy SEALs stage an attack. The Navy wouldn't do it. Think tanks talked about it. But then Iran said a few months ago, if you do sanctions, we'll do this. So I'm rarely at a loss trying to figure out who I think the prime suspect is. And I've been so busy. I check World Affairs Brief almost every day. I've been so busy the last day. I haven't checked it. And right before I went on air, I said, please call Joel Skousen. My gosh, he's so smart. Former Vietnam-era naval aviator, best-selling author. Of course, his uncle wrote the book on the globalist and the naked communist, the naked capitalist, Cleon Skousen. So you probably can't get a smarter analyst on. So I don't know his views. We're going to find out his views right now. Is it a false flag? Is it an internal group? Is it Saudi Arabia? Would Israel stage this? With the history of staging false flags at sea, Trump says he thinks it's Iran. What in the world's going on, Joel Skousen, editor-in-chief at worldaffairsbrief.com? What do you think's happening?
Well, thank you, Alex. It's good to be with you again. Iran is the victim of another false flag operation, and we don't know exactly who's done it, but it's obviously connected to the U.S. deep state who does these things. The biggest thing that has turned Donald Trump, and he's, by the way, has been very reluctant to buy into this Iran war scenario up until today, when he finally got convinced, because they pulled they have a two or three levels of false flag or false intelligence information they can deliver to the president. They used all three today. And the first one, of course, was the several weeks ago, the mines that hit four tankers in the UAE. And today, of course, yesterday, there were these tankers that were hit. But, you know, they show this boat, as you're showing on screen right now, coming up and supposedly removing a limpet mine from the side of the ship. But this is false on its face because, first of all, limpet mines are placed below the waterline. It doesn't do any good to place them above the waterline. The reason that they have these damage marks above the waterline is that the crew of the Courageous, which is the Japanese tanker, said today and told the owner, it was a small missile that hit the boat. It was not a mine. They saw the missile come in and hit the boat above the waterline. And that's why the U.S. isn't showing the other side of the ship or where that particular damage is being shown. So,
you're the weapons expert, but I did notice normally with a shape charge like a limpet, because I looked it up, it would blow a circular hole into the hull. But it looks like a lot of missiles hit, and then they got a rod in them. They turned sideways. But if you look, it looks like about a 10-foot slash is in the boat. That wouldn't be a mine, would it?
That's right. Absolutely doesn't have the signature of a mine at all. And the U.S. is playing this because, you know, limpet mines are everywhere, and it's very easy. That's what they said it was before. But, you know, the fact that they showed this Iranian ship up alongside, and you've got to remember that Iran was involved in rescue operations. It's one of the closest Navy. It was much closer to the U.S. Navy to these ships. It immediately went to the rescue. And to say that they're removing a mine from the hull is just pure conjecture. And especially attempting to say they're trying to cover up for having put a mine on the boat that they wanted to recover to mask
the. What about the argument that they're deactivating the mine and nobody else would know how to do it? You're just saying there's no proof there is a mine.
No proof that there is a mine. That video is way too grainy to see, any detail of that. But it's just speculation. Now, that's definitely a very, probably a Iranian boat. But who can project the motives there? Let's go to the actual projection of motives. This is so important to understand, is that for what reason would Iran attack two tankers, and especially one Japanese-owned tanker, when Prime Minister Shinzo Abe was in Iran talking about peace? I mean, why do that? That's as bad as saying that Bashar al-Assad used chemical weapons on his own people when he knows that that's a trigger event for the U.S. to attack him, when he knows that chemical weapons have no use within a civilian population. They're a major area weapon. You can't control where it goes. You never use it in an urban area.
And Joel Skousen of World Affairs Brief, we're going to get into all this, but yesterday, and I'll just be honest, I mean, I was saying maybe Iran did do it because they have said we might sink ships a few months ago if you put sanctions on us as a threat. And so I see that as a tacit admission. But then I remember Dick Cheney, document cam shot, please, and Joel Skousen saying, provoke a war. He saw the documents. Cheney considered a proposal to dress up Navy SEALs as Iranians and then shoot at them when they tried to attack a tanker. Well, okay, let's not believe Pulitzer Prize winner. Maybe he's wrong. But then I have the Which Path to Persia, Options for a New American Strategy Towards Iran, put out as an analysis paper by the Middle East Policy Brookings Institution. And then they talk about staging a big event. So clearly they're salivating for this. And that I think, is a big piece of evidence this could be staged.
Well, Alex, the threat by Iran was only in case that we are attacked. They were never going to do this as a preemptive thing to, I mean, they're not stupid. The Iranians are some of the smartest people. And they're, by the way, the only ones in the Middle East group of big nations that have enough military power to really counter Saudi Arabia and the U.S. fomented war on terror. They're the ones that understand, just like the Russians did in Syria, that the U.S. is faking the war on terror, that they are, in fact, fomenting terror. They run the terrorist group. They ran ISIS. They created ISIS. And Iran knows that. And so the reason that they're so hostile to Israel is they know that Benjamin Netanyahu is a globalist and that Israel is taking orders from the globalists and is intent on attacking Iran.
All right, I agree. You're really convincing me. Joel Skousen, World Affairs Brief, really smart guy. Former naval aviator, best-selling author, great brain. He'll give us his take on where this is going next, straight ahead. Stay with us. You know, we've got one of the best geopolitical analysts out there, Joel Skousen, and his family is the gold standard, the platinum standard. We're not bragging. This is, he doesn't like to be bragged about, of anti-communism. When I was growing up, 5 years old, my grandfather, who was this super John Wayne American World War II vet, sitting around the table, I mean, he was like talking to my dad. I was like 5 years old reading the Naked Capitalist. He's like, and it's not just the commies. The big banks are playing the game to domesticate the public. We got to stop them, and you got to get in there and do it. And I'm sitting there listening to this. I'm like 5 years old. My dad's like, we're working on it. We're trying to whatever they were up to. Because my dad had been fighting communists since he was about 14 years old. And they're talking about Cleon Skousen. But when Joel comes on, he's saying, looks like a false flag. And the evidence starts to point towards that. Maybe I was wrong. I went with it yesterday because the Mullahs did threaten to, well, maybe we'll sink ships in the Strait of Hormuz. I mean, they did do that, I think probably foolishly. But you look at all the angles and the way it's all being played out and the neocons. I'm really worried, Joel, that as much as I hate Venezuela, if they can trick Trump into a military action, they'll Bay of Pigs Trump. And I'm really worried about a Bay of Pigs canard here to say Trump screwed up, Trump crashed the economy. If we get lured into Iran war, many experts believe, and I believe, it could kill the economy. Big picture, instead of the event itself, let's just say you're right, it's a false flag. What's the big picture? Who's behind it? What could it do? What war could it lead to?
Well, there's two angles, basically. There maybe three. It would hurt the United States economy. Oil prices would skyrocket. You're going to pay for it at the pump. Insurance prices of all the tankers shipping oil around are going to go up 400% if there's a war. But I can tell you, Iran would not provoke it. They know that they're at a disadvantage. They have a strong ability to respond to the U.S., but they're going to get taken down, and they know it. So they're not going to provoke this thing. They would only sink a tanker in the strait if they are attacked and there's a full-scale war to punish Saudi Arabia and the U.S. and their allies for going to war against them. But there's another agenda, too. Remember, in the big picture, Iran is the only Muslim country that is threatening and is really, frankly, there in many regards to be the self-sufficient in weaponry, from everything from aircraft to missiles to rockets. They're a potential force. They're no Iraq. If the U.S. goes to war against Iran, it's going to be costly, and Iran is going to
And by the way, all the military family I have that are, you know, officers and things, they say the same thing. They say, you don't want to go with Iran. They're dug in. They're ready. Attacking them makes them stronger.
That's right. But remember, too, that there's a major globalist agenda towards World War III. And Iran, they're going to war. I don't think Russia's going to back Iran to the extent that they'll go to war with the U.S. over attacking Iran. But they know, the Russians know, that the U.S. does them a service by building up this image as the bully of the world, and the U.S. will be viewed as the bully. There's an increasing amount of people on the
And this is your thesis. You've always said the globalists are trying to lure the U.S. into war where we look like the bad guy.
That's right. We look like the bad guys. We have to look like the bad guys so that Russia and China can feel justified in striking, and it won't appear as the aggressors to the rest of the world.
And like you said, Trump at first, he's been very resistant to this. It's a very, whether Iran did it or not, and I think it's not in their interest. Maybe they think we're weak. You go the other angle that they're like, you know, North Korea, brinksmanship, get some better deals. But let's just say you're right. I think things lean towards that. I think you're right. Why would Trump then start slumping towards this?
Well, here's the problem with Donald Trump. just like in North Korea, once he buys into or gets snookered into a deception, like he did with Kim Jong-un, being convinced that Kim was sincere and he's going to, no matter what the evidence
is, he's so positive that he isn't going to quit trying to get it done.
That's right. He's not going to back down. His ego won't let him admit I was dead wrong about Kim Jong-un. And the same thing now is about this false flag. He's gone on several talk shows claiming that Iran is the bad guy and Iran's going to pay for this, et cetera, and I just don't think he's going to back down. You know, years or months after he went to war with Syria and he realized, hey, this didn't look very good. It looks like the U.S. or the intelligence people falsified the information about the chemical weapons to Assad, and they did. They've done it three or four times. He may have regrets after this, but I think you may be right. Iran is going to be a bad war. It's going to be it's going to hurt Donald Trump. It's going to hurt the economy. He could be terminally damaged by the mistake of this war.
Well, I want to do five more minutes on the other side with you and then finish up. But let me just bring this up now. And I'm not trying to bring myself into the story. We got secret Google documents a year and a half ago before deplatforming that they admitted were real. $15 million to pay outside groups to go post lies about us to downvote us. So they paid thousands of people to work for months around the clock doing things on the web so it would actually organically be real, but still a fraud. And they talked about you, they talked about Ron Paul, they talked about me, and they said, we cannot allow Alex Jones to say the next chemical attack is fake. He and Ron Paul and Joel Skousen, I don't know if you saw this, they listed the shows, are fake news and work for the Russians, which is preposterous, obviously. And that's how they, you can type in, guys, Google documents show plan to delist InfoWars. And when you read why it is, and then even UN reports have come out, and they now admit that the chemical attacks were staged. But I was told this by the White House, actually, just a few weeks ago when I was in D.C. a month ago, and I met with some U.S. intelligence guys that are good. They said, Alex, they're not mad at you about talking about trannies and stuff. They're mad that you keep getting involved in geopolitics and that they're listening to you, and that when they run a false flag, people will listen to you. And so, again, that shows how concerned they are about you and Ron Paul. Go ahead.
Well, you know, I've outlined everything I've said about Iran in today's World Affairs Brief. Your listeners can get a free copy of that issue by emailing me at editor@worldaffairsbrief.com. Normally, there's a modest subscription for the World Affairs Brief, about $1 a week. But everybody can get that free copy today. The only thing that isn't in the brief is the story that came out this morning about the Japanese owner of the tanker saying it was an aerial vehicle that exploded in the ship above the waterline that his crew saw. It was not a mine.
Stay there. Let's talk about that in a moment. So stay right there. Do five more minutes. But I'm going to say this right now. People think like, oh, it's not sexy to go to worldaffairsbrief.com and pay $4 a week to get all this incredible analysis. And I'm not paid to say this. He's not a sponsor. Folks, that's like Matt Drudge came here 3 years ago to say, I've met with top people. He told me the names at the time. The UN's taking over the internet. The EU's taking over. You've got to work, Alex. You're going to be shut down. And I kind of took it like, okay, let me get, he's like, you got to set up your own systems now. You got to set up your own banks now. And this is what they said. This is who they are. And I was like, okay, yeah. I listened to him, but not enough. What is important is individual websites, emails, information you can share. They're moving against it all. So go to worldaffairsbrief.com, become a subscriber, and I'll tell you about InfoWars. Ladies and gentlemen, they don't want guests on here like Ron Paul and Joel Skousen. They don't want the fact that I'm here having real debates with everybody and not with a talking point. I'm like, did they do it? Did they didn't? They don't like that real discussion and getting people thinking and questioning. And they're working around the clock against us. And we've got a lot of things going on to continue on. We've got a lot of things to metastasize. They see it as a disease. We're metastasizing right now in a beautiful way. But I'm telling you right now, I need your financial support. I need people to understand, especially wealthy and middle-class people, because so many of our supporters are just blue-collar, wonderful people that don't have the money. Yeah, fish oil is great. Yeah, turmeric's great. Our products, get a T-shirt. They're all wonderful. But I'm going to stay the course. And I almost, in the fourth hour, don't want to tell you what they're up to because it has scared some employees off, okay? And I really haven't told people what's going on. They harass my employees' families. They harass my family. They run psyops. They try to have women, beautiful women, you know, in grocery stores that we're trying, and I'm of course like, you know, I mean, it's bad, folks, okay? And I'm not complaining. I'm just saying it's because we're doing something very important. And the fact that I'm working 16 hours a day and don't do all this stuff, my only problem is drinking, and I've cut back on that. The fact that I'm not a worldly person when it comes to stuff, they can't get me. They are so pissed, and they've really tried to set us up, and we've reported to the FBI, and they say we're the victim, but they're coming for me, folks. And I'm not a victim. I just want to keep going if I can, but if I have to finish strong, they kill me, whatever, I'm going to go all the way. But I need money. I want to fight these bastards to the very last. I want to give them everything I've got. And the spirit's ready, but I need money. It's a war. I need money. My God, I already sell you incredible products, okay? They're always rated the best. We only mark them up 150%. Everybody else does 7 times. I would never do that. And I've been lashed by experts I've talked to. They go, Jones, mark it up 300%. Your problems will be solved. The point is, ladies and gentlemen, is that I need funding, and that's why we've launched an emergency 50% off all InfoWars Life supplement products. Save InfoWars emergency special because, man, they got people following me. And they can't get to me, so they're harassing my entire family now. They are running psyops. They've got the CIA all over my ass. It is. They got people, and I'm not complaining. We're over the target, folks. We're over the target, but we need capital to complete the mission. So commit now. InfoWarsStore.com. Do it. We'll be right back. I feel guilty every day when I get off here because I haven't covered all the news. I don't have one. There's like 3 videos of people being elected that are communists the last week to city councils and other positions saying any means necessary, violent communist overthrow. I'm going to hit that in about 15 minutes. Owen Schroyer is going to a drag queen story time where they don't tell the public at regular story times that huge pot-bellied men, many of them convicted pedophiles, are going to be there. He's going to be there. Antifa is promising violence to anyone that shows up. So I don't want to give them a little clue, but I'm going to be there. He threatened violence. I'm coming. But we're definitely going to have our people there, and Owen's going to be there. He's popping in about 20 minutes. Joel Skousen of worldaffairsbrief.com, great political analyst. You know, I hope you're wrong about being a false flag, but regardless, I've asked a lot of questions here. Any other points in the 4 minutes we have left? Or we're going to do one more segment. We have 15 minutes left. But we'll just finish up about the event itself, and then when we come back, what would a strike look like if the neocons or the globalists are behind this? What do you think their end game is? Go ahead.
Let me first cover another big picture issue. You know, the United States keeps putting out the most egregious disinformation I've ever heard, that Iran is the greatest sponsor of terror in the world. Now, in fact, there is no documented cases of Iran directly or indirectly doing any terrorism in the Western world. It's all Al-Qaeda and ISIS, which are controlled by the U.S. deep state, that are doing these terrorist attacks. What Iran is doing is fighting the U.S. phony war on terror in Yemen, because the Yemenis government was overthrown by rebels who basically were fed up with Yemen's government supporting the phony war on terror and sending arms to ISIS and others. And they were overthrown. And that's why Saudi Arabia and the U.S. are trying to destroy the Yemenis rebels. Iran is supporting Hezbollah. Now, Hezbollah nor Iran, these are Islamic states. These are not good guys in particular in terms of the liberty of their own people, but they're not aggressors against other countries. None of these countries, Yemen, Hezbollah, or Iran, are trying to conquer other countries, but they know they're under the target and attack of the globalists, and that's why they are attempting to defend themselves and building up these military forces. It's the U.S. and the deep state that are the aggressors. And unfortunately, Donald Trump doesn't know anything about the deep state sponsoring terror. And that's why he believes these false intelligence things.
Well, he used to get it saying Hillary and Obama founded ISIS, which is basically true. But yeah, he ordered troops out of Afghanistan. It didn't happen. He ordered Brennan to lose his security clearance. It didn't happen. Let's just face it. Trump's biggest failure is he's allowed mutiny in the government. But I don't expect a real estate magnate to know how to deal with that. You're a smart guy. You used to head up the big conservative councils. You know, how would you deal with mutiny in government?
Well, you've got to have a core people ready to come in and take over the NSA, the CIA, and the FBI. And every one of those organizations has a dark side and a white side. You need to have people who are perceptive, who know how to listen to the warning voice of conscience, to go out and find out who are the white guys, who are the black guys, and get rid of the black guys and put the white guys into place. Because you cannot prosecute these people who are deep state unless you get control of the prosecutory elements. You've got to purge the DOJ. You've got to purge the courts of people.
No, I totally agree. Trump clearly doesn't have full control of the Justice Department. How would you call the Justice Department now? Because we see some good out of the Inspector General, but no action.
Well, and that's where you get derailed on these things. For example, Mark Huber, the prosecutor, special prosecutor from Utah that was brought in, to investigate the Hillary Clinton scandal, James Comey, and all of those types. He did nothing. We find out now that, Bill Barr, the attorney general that everybody thinks is pro-Trump, he's actually just faking it because he is deep state. He was the bag man for Herbert Walker Bush and, covered for Iran.
Let's talk about that when we come back, because I've been told by smart folks in D.C. and you're smart that, let me tell you, Bob Barr is doing them a favor. He's trying to save deep state from themselves because they believe they push Trump too hard. He may do something, and he's just trying to get them to stop it. But he may be trying to set Trump up. Let's talk about that. Let's talk about what happens if there's a war with Iran. What unfolds with Joel Skousen of worldaffairsbrief.com. I'm Alex Jones with News Wars. You realize the globalists work around the clock to stop those URLs getting out. We're going to get them out there. So let me ask Joel Skousen, editor-in-chief, World Affairs Brief, geopolitical analyst, best-selling author, the royal family of anti-globalism, great work for 70, 80 years by his family, and the FBI, you name it. He's a naval aviator in his own right. Great geopolitical analyst, best-selling author. I mean, we sell his book, Strategic Relocation, the film Strategic Relocation, InfoWarsStore.com. Let me ask you this, then. What would you call the big picture globally about who Trump is, about how the globalists see things, what's happening to the euro, what's happening with nationalism? What would you call this current system, this current world program or atmosphere or condition we're in?
I would say that the globalists are struggling to control the narrative. They have become very unpopular, the anti-globalist movements in Europe and the Brexit in the United States, coupled with Trump. This is part of an anti-globalist movement. We're tired of the same old thing, never getting in. That's why they elected Trump. And so they're controlling the narrative, and they're doing it successfully. Theresa May sabotaged the Brexit successfully. Boris Johnson, he gets to prime minister, and it will do the same. He's not really in favor of the sovereignty issue. The Freedom Party has been sabotaged in Austria because of U.S. Eavesdropping and setting them in a honey trap where they could reveal a video about these people and get them out of power in Austria. So every place, the anti-globalists are winning. The powers that be are mounting up tremendous pressure. And I see that in Donald Trump himself. Now, the problem with Trump is that he had a fantastic story and a promise to give to the American people. And at least half of the voters bought it. And it's been disappointing because he hasn't delivered on it. Not because Donald Trump isn't sincere. I'm not one of those that believes that Donald Trump's a controlled entity. I believe.
No, I totally agree. I mean, he's real, but it's like anybody's not perfect. He just doesn't know how to deliver. I mean, look at this GOP rep, failure to secure border, going to be toughest Trump sell in 2020. But I'm sorry, I'm interrupting. You're right. I mean, I think Trump's real, but it just means he's not a globalist. It doesn't mean he's perfect.
That's right. You see, Donald Trump doesn't do any homework himself. He gets everything as a CEO by briefings. And so he is trapped by his briefings. He doesn't.
And let me stop you again. That's why I'm not bragging. Trump loves my briefings. He likes 3-4 minute briefings. I'm not going to brag on air, but we get requests for these. Okay. So I shoot these things on air and it gets to him. And that scares the hell out of them. But it's true. He literally, once he likes somebody, if his gut says they're good, he goes with it. I'm showing proof and stuff, too, on screen, but that scares the hell out of these roundtables.
It does. The weakness of Donald Trump, though, even though he may hear your briefing or he hears something correct on Fox News, he cannot remember the arguments. He doesn't have a bank of data in his brain to argue back. And so he gets these sophisticated globalist advisors who can talk him out of almost anything.
No, you're right. They sit around, like you said, and they know. That's what I've been told. They'll send four. You said three. No, I'm told they'll send four different branches in, and giving him the same thing. And he goes, well, my God, then it must be true.
Yeah. You know, a person like myself or yourself, we could counter those things. We could embarrass them if they tried to throw that phony, you know, briefing. But Donald Trump simply doesn't have the data bank, the experience. He's never been in the conservative movement. He's running on gut instinct. And unfortunately, that instinct fails him sometimes. I mean, he picked Gina Haspel, part of the dark side of the CIA.
Oh, he brought in a top person from Soros's group for personnel. So let me ask you, who are the good guys, who are the bad guys from your research? What about Pompeo? Is he a neocon, or what do you think?
No, Pompeo's not a good guy. Pompeo is completely sold out to the globalist side, and he is pumping up everything about Iran. Bolton is on the other side. He's a pure neocon. The only thing Bolton has ever been right about was North Korea, and the globalists don't exactly like that, but they've compromised that. North Korea isn't going to be taken down. What I want to concentrate, one of the most telling things is what happened with the John Huber situation and Bill Barr. Bill Barr gave an interview with CBS.
You're right, Bill Barr. I was saying Bob Barr. I apologize.
Bill Barr, the attorney general, gave an interview to CBS, and he admitted that John Huber has done nothing in 2 years to uncover all the investigatory thing about Hillary Clinton. And the reason he gave was that he was waiting for Michael Horowitz, the DOJ inspector general, to do it. And that's absolutely bogus. Mark Huber could have been doing his own investigation parallel to that. And in fact, Bill Barr says, now we're going to investigate this thing. Well, look, the information is already there. The private investigators, fiscal investigators that investigated and got all the dirt on Hillary Clinton's campaign gave.
No, exactly. Reason. We've got enough dirt, 1,000 ways to get rid of her. Clearly, they're threatening everyone around Trump. They're all scared to act. So how do you get past the intimidation?
But the point is that John Huber got that information 3 times. He lost it 2 times. On the 3rd time, he finally admitted that he received it, and then he did nothing with it. So you don't need to have another 2 years that Bill Barr is saying we're going to investigate.
So instead of talking about Bill Barr, you're saying it's compromised, and I agree, he's like a thoroughbred of the establishment, and Trump's acting like he's a savior because he at least stands up for him. That's probably shilling. What would you do? Because, Joel, the president, we could probably get this 3 minutes. 3 minutes to break. Joel Skousen, your message to the president.
Well, my message, first of all, to the president is to help him understand the deep state. The deep state created ISIS. The deep state runs terror. And you're not going to get correct briefings from the deep state about, I would correct him on Syria, on Assad, on Iran, on Yemen, and get him to stop those things. And I would also tell him, you know, you've got to get new people in here. And, you know, you and I could help him find people who could staff those things to redo the CIA, the NSA. And all the major elements that, and including the DAA, which has knowledge of all the drug smuggling that keeps coming in through the border through Mexico. And I would advise him immediately on how to get this border shut down. You know, one of his problems with the state of emergency, he used it with just itty bitty increments. You know, we're using the state of emergency to justify some funding for a little bitty tiny bit of the wall. So now he's wasted the state of emergency because it won't be effective. He needed to say, this is my constitutional duty to protect the lives and property of American citizens that are being violated by this invasion. It is not about congressional authority over the budgeting. The point is, my duty is to protect lives and property, and I'm going to do that as president, and that means a declaration of emergency. I'm going to use the military to line that border and have arms, and they're going to have ability to shoot and to arrest.
And by the way, that's in the Constitution, as you know, and then he did this little side deal, and then even Rand Paul's trying to restrict a clearly constitutional role.
Yeah, he's claiming this is a violation of posse comitatus, and it isn't, because this is not an issue of military managing law enforcement within the
United
States.
Yeah, it's a territorial border that's in the Constitution. Yeah.
This is a federal issue. This is a military issue. This is an invasion, and you can stop it. And additionally, you know, as I covered in today's World Affairs Brief, he let Mexico off the hook with paper promises. He should have said, here's going to be a 10% duty right now on Monday, and it's going to stay there.
And by the way, you're so right, Joel. They're already backing off saying, we can't stop unlimited numbers. Well, we can't take unlimited numbers.
Well, that's right. And you got to say, those tariffs are going to go up in proportion to while the illegals continue to flow across the border, and they'll come down if you, Mexico, stop those illegals. They talked about stopping the funding of 26 big corporations in their bank accounts. It's the thousands of coyotes that deal in cash. Mexico is
Joel, if you've been on, you've only been on for like 30 minutes. Come back for a full hour this week or next week. We love you. We appreciate your time. Years go by like seconds. Let's do a whole hour on what you'd advise Trump to do. But I know this. We can bitch about Trump all day, and I do. But imagine having a company where no one follows your orders. At the end of the day, we have a rogue government that's not doing what he says. And worldaffairsbrief.com. I'm Alex Jones, Infowars.com. Great advice to the president right there. ICE has given him advice at newswars.com. They've said change the asylum rules and all the rest of it. But absolutely, it's the federal government's purview. It's its mission to defend the border. Joel, thank you so much for your wisdom.
My pleasure.
We'll be right back with Owen Schroyer. He's going to face armed Antifa tomorrow at a library where men fondle children.
I said one time, who's in charge here?
And I think the congressman's right about that fact. Jerry, you want some? Yeah, I got some here. Jerry, take a drink. You look a little dehydrated, brother. You seem a little dehydrated. You okay?
A little longer on the floor than I had anticipated in the custody of the Border Patrol. Everyone, he started sending signals, the U.S., Mexico, Canada, if that's not the accurate category. Some people call it AFTA NAFTA, some call it NAFTA 2.0, working together to pass that.
You seem a little dehydrated, you okay? You want to take a break with us?
But the president again stormed out. I think, what, first pound the table, walk out the door. But I intend not to, if we, we're the fat, we, the three things.
Three things.
You want to take a break with us to give yourself some? Mm-hmm. How you feel, man? You okay?
What happened?
You all right? Okay, do you want to drink some of this and give you some electrolyte? How you feel, man? You feel okay?
What happened?
We can walk and chew gum at the same time. I hope he can, too.
I want to just put out a message right now to the Democrats, because, look, your leaders, Nancy Pelosi and Jerry Nadler, are struggling. And so we've got BrainForce Plus at InfoWarsStore.com. And if there has ever been an example of somebody that needs BrainForce Plus, the neural activator, it's Nancy Pelosi and it's Jerry Nadler. Now, unfortunately, we're not miracle workers here, and we can only do so much with our great supplements at InfoWarsStore.com. But if there's any hope at all for Nancy Pelosi or Jerry Nadler to get their brain working, it's BrainForce Plus from InfoWarsStore.com. And if you're ever feeling like a Pelosi or a Nadler and you can't think or talk straight or move, BrainForce Plus is the answer. So don't be a Pelosi and fumble and bumble through a press conference like a gibbering idiot. Don't be a Jerry Nadler who can't even think or pick his head up and look forward during a press conference. Go to InfoWarsStore.com and get yourself some BrainForce Plus. You don't want to look like Pelosi, okay? You don't want to look like Nadler. You want to look sharp. You want your mind to be sharp. So go to InfoWarsStore.com and get your BrainForce Plus today.